Living water. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, that is what God wants for you. That's His purpose, that you have a life that is saturated with prayer and the presence of God is to pray. Hallelujah. I love it. And the Spirit of God in Romans chapter 8, and I was reading and we'll read a lot more in Romans chapter 8 later on, but these few verses here, it says this: likewise the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. Verse 26, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. I'm telling you, there's only three that know the will of God: the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And God gave us the Holy Ghost so that we would know what the will of God is. And you only get that when you pray in the Spirit. When you get the Holy God and you let God break down His Spirit, and the Spirit begins to reveal to you what His will is for your life. And He's got a plan and a purpose for all of you, especially you, Patrick. He's got a plan for you, yes. And He knows it. And I'm telling you, it's exciting to know and receive the will of God. And it can only come through the Holy Ghost. As He makes known to you God's will and purpose and plan in the Word of God and outside of the Word of God, just begin to map out your life day after day after day after day.
Amen.
It's so exciting living this way for God. I'm telling you, I wouldn't trade for anything in the world. I don't get up, hallelujah, and just go through a normal day. It never's happened in 48 years. Every day that I've ever lived and gone out to serve the Lord, it's always been exciting. Something's always happened. It's just an amazing journey with the Lord. But it begins right there in prayer and praise in the Holy Ghost. It's a direct line to God. And just as Jesus Christ is ever interceding in heaven, the Holy Spirit is ever interceding within us. His Spirit groaning with our spirit and revealing. And have you ever gone into prayer and the Holy Ghost came around? Brother Phillips, I know this happened to you many times. You would pray and the Holy Ghost comes on you and just begin to just tremble in the presence of God. And you might be there praying, speaking in other tongues, maybe in a known tongue and an unknown tongue, going on for maybe an hour, just praying and weeping and not even understanding what you're praying for. And you find out some months later, years later, what that was all about. And you, sometimes you don't know, sometimes you do know. I've had things happen to me. Holy Ghost, can we start praying and find out immediately what was happening that day? And that God had me on my knees praying at that moment for that soul, that purpose, that mission, whatever was going on. It was through the power of the Holy Ghost, through prayer. I'm telling you, that's the purpose of the Holy Ghost. To be a witness through the power of our prayer life. Secondly, to overcome. We're spelling the word power. Everybody say power.
Power.
Prayer.
Prayer.
And praise. That's the P. Now He's given us power to overcome. Power to pray. I can preach on that for the next week. I left out tons. You can get your cheese and crackers next week. Power to overcome temptations, powers of darkness, and every snare of the enemy. Jesus entered into the wilderness in the fullness of the Spirit, the Bible says, and was tempted by Satan himself, but was able to overcome and come out victorious. Why? Because he went into that wilderness. You read about it. I'm telling you, right there in the scriptures in Luke chapter 4, he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Read it. Luke chapter 4 verse 1. And in Luke chapter 4 verse 14 it says this: he returned in the power of the Spirit. He went in led by the Spirit. He returned in the what? The power of the Holy Ghost. You see what happens when you go through testings and trials and temptations, and the devil throws everything he can at you and he fails. He tries to knock you down. He tries to knock you down. He tries to deceive you, lie to you, and tempt you, and do everything he can to pull you down. And you overcome. Every time you overcome. Every time you overcome. When you come out of that, you're going to come out of the power and the authority of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You're going to know, my God is here. My God is here. to do all things. Hallelujah. Jesus came out of that wilderness, man. I'm telling you, he was ready to conquer the world. He was ready to lead his disciples. He was ready to establish his church. He was ready to begin the purpose that God had for him on this earth. And I'm telling you, it's the same for you and I. If we try to go through life without the Holy Spirit, you're going to be defeated. You're going to be messed up. You're going to be always down. You'll be like this in your Christian life, or you can be like this.
Yes, amen.
I tell you, I can't hardly handle it sometimes. I never know how my people are going to come to church. That's why I let Ron and Libby be the leaders out there. They come in sometimes, hey, Ron, how you doing? Praise the Lord. Good to see you, Ron. The next Sunday they come in, he's gone. I wonder what I did to them. I always make it a purpose when I come out of my office and I see Ron. Hey, Ron, how you doing? Greet them when you come in. Let them know. You got the victory. Hallelujah. You used to have some people, when they come to my church, I can tell by the look on their face. Whoa, don't talk to them. They're in a bad mood. Things went wrong. Something happened between them and their wife, or their wife and him, and who knows? You just kind of backed away. Oh, I don't want to get into too many illustrations here. You might know who I'm talking about. Allow me this. If you're walking in the Spirit, and you're filled with the Spirit, and you're obeying the Spirit of God, and you're allowing Him to have His way in your life, you cannot sin. You cannot sin. If you're being led by the Spirit, if you are filled with the Spirit, if you're being obedient to the Spirit, you cannot sin. So if you sin, it means you're in the flesh. If you sin, it means you've come out from underneath that anointing, that obedience to the Holy Ghost, and you've yielded to do what you want to do. But as long as you do what God wants you to do, you give you a power and an authority over sin, over temptation, over the powers of the devil, and that's the way God wants us to live. The problem is we don't live there. We'd rather have cheese and crackers instead of lobster. I tell you, that's exactly what it is. We don't want to have that. We don't want to take the time to get it. We want to go through life enjoying what we want to enjoy, being led by the flesh instead of being led by the Spirit. But they that are led by the Spirit and lived in the Spirit won't sin. You can rise above it. You can overcome. You can live for God. You can overcome. I don't care what heaven is, what you're going through in life. The problem is not with God or the Spirit. It's with us.
Yes.
So when we sin, who do we blame? Huh? Don't blame God. Oh, you better blame yourself. You got in the flesh. You follow the passions. And when that lust hath conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it's finished, brings forth death, James says. In Galatians chapter 5, he says the Spirit and the flesh are warring. They're warring against each other all the time. And the Spirit of God is saying, do this. And the flesh is saying, do this. You know, don't eat that cherry pie. Don't eat it. Don't eat it. Your cholesterol's high. You're going to die behind it. And don't do it. No. The flesh. Just one bite. Oh, maybe two bites. Oh, this is the whole thing. Have you ever been there? Hey! That's like water. My weakness is ice cream. I'll put it in a little bowl. I put it in a little bowl now. My problem is I fill up that little bowl so many times. Eventually I just go get the half gallon out of it. So I fix it in a gallon. She might as well gallon. Just get the whole thing out and start eating it. Then I get under conviction, I'm not going to eat ice cream. And I said, well, buy that, don't even put it in the freezer. I don't want to see it. I go out and look in the freezer, longing for some ice cream, and it's not there. My flesh is crying, and the Spirit of me is going to say, go and pray. Get a hold of God. Learn to live what it's like to fast ice cream and get off that stuff. It's addicting, it's powerful, it'll destroy you. That's the war we go through. How many go through that every day of your life? It's called the flesh and the Spirit. How many have flesh here today? Pinch yourself. Hey, does it hurt? If it don't, you're in trouble. As long as you're in the flesh, you'll have your battle. The only way to overcome it to the power of the Holy Ghost. I'm going to prove it to you. Turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 7. I didn't tell James to put this up here. He's going to do Romans 8 in a second, but I want to read this to you. It's powerful. And you need to get it. You need to get this. But as a Bible school, they made us memorize Romans 5, 6, 7, and 8. We had to memorize it. You'll see why. It says this. Verse 18 of chapter 7. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. How many know that? In your flesh dwelleth no good thing. I don't care how much God says you're handsome, you look great. That's a lie. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not. For the good that I would do, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do. Now if I do that, I would not, it is no more I that do it, but what? Sin that dwelleth in me. Don't ever blame it on God or the Holy Ghost. Whenever you sin, it's the law of sin working in you. It's the flesh, and you're yielding to it, and you have no one to blame for that but yourself.
The ice cream.
I find that in law, that when I would do good, evil is present with me. Is this making sense to you?
Yeah.
Does this sound like you? Sounds so much like me. In fact, Paul's writing this. This is Paul's life. He says, for I delight in the law of God after the inward man. How many here be delight after God? I wake up every morning delighting after God. I wake up every morning wanting God in my life. But something happens through the day. But I see another law in my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. But then he goes on to say this. Now I want you to put this up if you can, James. Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 16. 16 times he makes reference to the Holy Spirit in 16 verses. I want to read it to you. There is therefore no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the what? The flesh, but after the Spirit. Verse 2. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. So the law of what? The Spirit. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak, through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh. Verse 4. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the what?
Spirit.
The Spirit. Let's go on. I want you to get this. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. 16 times it's mentioned. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually, I count that as one, spiritually minded is life and peace, because you can't be spiritually minded without the Spirit. Okay? That's first. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God. It wars against God. That's the flesh. That's what we struggle with. That's what we battle with. But, hallelujah, for it is not subject to the law of God. Neither indeed can be. So don't think for one second this flesh can overcome anything.
Amen.
You can go all the hunger strikes you want, do this and do that. Everything. As long as you're in the flesh, you're not going to succeed in here. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. I'm going to get to this in a second. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Verse 12. Therefore, brethren, be ye debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh, but for if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify, kill, put to death the deeds of the body, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Verse 15, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the Spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. Verse 16. The Spirit itself bearing witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. 16 times in 16 verses, the Holy Spirit. What is Paul trying to get across to us? Church, it's this. If you're going to overcome, if you're going to live the life that God wants you to live, you cannot do it in yourself. It will take the Holy Spirit to make it possible. And you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. I'm not talking about an initial experience, speaking in tongues and saying, oh, hallelujah, I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. No. We're going to talk about being filled, keeping filled, empty, filled with the Spirit of God. Since He is right there, He is bubbling up in your soul. You are being led by the Spirit of God. He is in control of your life. I can tell when the Holy Ghost is leading me, and I can tell when the flesh is leading me. Amen. You can too.
That's right.
And the problem with most of us in our families, in our homes, in our lives, it's more the flesh than it is the Spirit.
Amen. Amen. Right.
We need to get this, don't we?
Yes.
So much I need to say here. I just had to read that to you. I had to read it to you. I know that's a lot of words. It's probably more words than most of you have had in 3 weeks. But anyways, I had to give it to you. Galatians 5 is another whole section. You need to read about that, the war that's going on. I'm telling you this. But I love how Romans ends. I love how it reads. Put it up there, verse 35. I love how it ends. This is great. Who shall separate us? If you live in the Spirit, you follow the Spirit, you do what the Spirit of God wants you to do, and you're spiritually minded, and you're mortifying the deeds of the flesh to the power of the Holy Ghost, and you live a victorious life, overcoming. It says, you can say like Paul of old. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Oh, let's go on. As it is written, for thy sakes are we killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. God doesn't say it's going to be easy. You're going to go through battles and struggles and everything else, but you can rise above it and overcome. Hallelujah. Nay. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. Hallelujah. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, or principalities, hallelujah, they're great, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, I love the catalog that puts that, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God,
yes,
which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's what I call victory. Romans 8. 7 is about the struggle between the flesh and the spirit. Romans 8 is about living in the spirit. Living, walking, breathing, controlled by the Holy Ghost. I love it when I'm in the spirit. And I absolutely hate it when I'm in the flesh.
Amen.
I hate it. Those things we had to battle through. How are we hungry? Huh? That's the flesh. That's where you need the Holy Spirit to temper it, to control it. Huh? How many struggle with habits? Huh? Got some habits? The only answer is the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost, you can struggle, you can battle, you can fight it all you want. Fight, or you can yield to the Holy Ghost. Just do like Paul, begin to speak in tongues all day long. You won't have time to smoke a cigarette. You won't be have time to eat ice cream.
Yes.
That's a good way. Speaking tongues for about, you think that's funny, but we, first guy that got filled with the Holy Ghost in answer, his name was Paul Cannon. He was right over here. His hands raised up, he was worshiping the Lord. I was going to preach that night on the Holy Ghost and power, but never got to it, Patrick. Paul's over there. When his hands went up, there were seven more, their hands went up, and I said, wow, God's moving in our church. They've never seen it happen before. We've been there 6 months, and it was dead as a doornail. That's why I see Paul there, and I thought, dear God, I better go pray for him. He's got his hands up. And so I stepped off the platform, six other hands, and there's seven all together. In the front pew, their hands went up. I said, we're seeking for the Holy Ghost. First time they never saw it. I just didn't know what was going to happen. I just told him I was going to preach on the Holy Ghost, and the Spirit of God wouldn't let me. The Spirit of God said, just invite them to come and pray. So I invited the whole church on Sunday night to come and pray, and they got in the front. It's a long story behind that. God had already shown me that afternoon the seven people that were going to be filled with the Holy Spirit. I wrote them down in my Bible. I told my wife, I said, God's going to do something for them. We'd never seen an outpouring of the Holy Ghost. We'd never seen these things happen before in the church in Port Loco. It was terrible. It was a disaster. The pastor had been there just before we got there. So did all the pews. He was a drunkard, an alcoholic. We took over this little work of about 15 people, and we had about 60 at that time, and some of them, they came up, and they were in this pew, and I went over to lay my hands on them. As I went to touch him, Brother George, the power of God hit him. He fell, speaking in other tongues. And as he fell, he just went down on each one of them. Seven. I filled with the Holy Ghost miraculous. I went berserk. I went crazy. I tell you, I went crazy. I wish it was unbelievable. It was so real. I'm just going back and forth saying, this is real. I'm 21 years old. I'm thank God. I'm